Okay, so just to revise what we did in the last lecture, we looked at interface response functions, and then I went on to describe diffusion control growth. And an interface response function, maybe I didn't use that terminology, but this is what it means.
Okay.
That here we have a process which is limited by diffusion, and the strength of this resistor describes that limitation. In other words, how much of the available free energy is dissipated in this particular process. And if most of it is dissipated in diffusion, we call it diffusion control growth. If most of it is consumed in transferring atoms across the interface because we have a different orientation on the other side, then we call it interface control growth. And notice that these are in series. That means all of these processes must happen in order for the particle to grow. But some of them might be easier than others, and therefore they take up less free energy. You can have circumstances where both processes are contributing equally, in which case we call that mixed control growth. Now, for diffusion control growth, we derived an equation which tells us that the particle size varies with the square root of dt. And we had other terms which come from the phase diagram and so on. So we can get a velocity from that theory. We can get a growth velocity from that theory. Similarly, today we'll derive an equation for interface control growth, and we'll have velocity as a function of the driving force. Now, obviously, both of these must give you exactly the same answer for the rate at which the particle grows, because both of the processes are happening at the same time. Right? You know, the current going through each of these resistors is exactly identical. That means the velocity of the interface, whether you calculate it from diffusion theory or whether you calculate it from interface theory, must be identical. But the problem is that we don't know how much of the free energy is dissipated in this process and how much in this. But the clue is that the proportion that's dissipated in this must be such that when we use the two different equations for the growth rate of the particle, you must get the same velocity. There's only one interface moving. So whatever theory you use to calculate the growth rate, you must get the same answer. Is that clear? So the equation we derived for diffusion control growth is one interface response function. Now we'll do the case where the barrier across the interface for the transfer of atoms from one side to the other is large, okay, and we'll call that G star, the free energy barrier between the parent and the product phases. And of course, this is the free energy change which is driving the parent phase to decompose into the product phase, right? Now, what will be the probability of jumps in this direction?
Exponential rate.
Yeah. So exponential minus G star or KT. Yeah? Just from Boltzmann statistics, right? What about the probability of jumping in the reverse direction? Because we have to look at both.
G star plus.
Yep, exactly. So for the forward direction, the chances of successful jumps is minus G star upon KT exponential. And for the reverse direction is that, which I can expand as this, okay? So it follows that the net flux of atoms in the forward direction is simply the difference between these two, which is this. So we have G star upon KT out here, and 1 minus exponential delta G upon KT. Okay? So that is simply the difference between this and this. And this velocity, the rate at which the interface moves, will be proportional to the net transfer of atoms. Now, you should be a little bit worried here, because we have a force and a flux. A flux, I'm talking generally now in terms of the thermodynamics of irreversible processes. We have a flux here and a force, and they're not linearly dependent, are they? Yeah, you remember in the theory of irreversible thermodynamics, we said, look, forces and fluxes are proportional to each other. We've just derived a rigorous equation which says that the velocity is actually proportional to 1 minus exponential of the driving force over kt. Any ideas? What I should really have discovered which is that the velocity should be proportional to delta g. Because velocity times delta g is the free energy dissipation rate. What was the sort of, how did we prove that the force and the flux are proportional in the theory for irreversible processes? How did we prove that? How did we prove that J is proportional to capital X? Remember? Okay, let's go back. Does this ring a bell? Yeah? We simply did a Taylor expansion. We ignored higher order terms. And that is zero because that is the flux at zero force. And therefore we obtain the flux proportional to force. Obviously that is the problem because we may not be justified in ignoring higher order terms. Yeah? So if we take account of the fact that higher order terms will be small when the driving force is small, then we should be okay. So if we go back to our theory, our equation that we derived, yeah, if I set delta G to be small, then it actually becomes exactly the relationship we are after. So, the approximation for this term here, 1 minus exponential minus delta g upon kt, when delta g is small, is simply delta g upon kt. Yeah, prove that to yourselves. It's a very straightforward mathematical proof. So we recover that at small driving forces, indeed the velocity is proportional to the driving force. So notice we have proved that the theory for irreversible processes is valid when there are small deviations from equilibrium, in other words when delta G is small. Right? Everybody happy with that? Are you familiar with this approximation for an exponential? Okay, so we now have a second interface response function which is related to the transfer of atoms across the boundary, and a second way of calculating the velocity with which the particle grows. And of course this answer will be exactly the same as the one you get from diffusion control growth theory, as long as you put in the right amount of dissipation into the equation. And I'll show you how to find that right amount of dissipation into the equation. This is not the total free energy that's driving the process, it's the amount that's dissipated in the process of transferring atoms across the boundary. Just like in that resistor, we have the voltage partition into the voltage drop across R1 and R2. I'll come back to that right at the end. I'm going to deal now with a third interface response function, and that's related to something that we call solute trapping. Now, just to remind you, even though these two phases are of different chemical composition, there's no tendency for B to diffuse into this phase. This is richer in B and yet it won't diffuse. No matter how long you wait, these compositions will not change. And the reason is that the chemical potential of B in alpha is exactly the same as the chemical potential of B in gamma, and similarly for all other components. So it's the fact that the free energy, there are no free energy gradients, that these two phases of different chemical composition are in equilibrium. Now, supposing that we are growing the particles so rapidly that there isn't time for atoms to diffuse away into locations where they want to be, then they might become trapped. So if the interface is actually moving faster than the ability of a solid atom to diffuse away, then that solid atom will become trapped inside the product phase. And the formal meaning of trapping is that the chemical potential of that species is increased on transfer across the interface. So this is such a case. Clearly this is not the equilibrium composition, because the equilibrium composition is this one. It's given by the common tangent to the two free energy curves. Yeah, you can see this is the equilibrium composition and this one. Yeah. But if the precipitate is growing so rapidly that there is no time for solute B atoms to diffuse away, then the actual concentration will be larger than equilibrium. Okay? And notice that the chemical potential of the solute in the product phase is now larger than it would be if we had the equilibrium composition. Okay? So, in fact, its chemical potential is increased on transfer across the interface. That is the meaning of trapping. And solvent trapping, so I've talked about solute trapping, where we are talking about, say, a small concentration of a solute inside the solvent. If that solute is trapped in the product phase, then its chemical potential will be raised on transfer across the interface. Solvent trapping is when the chemical potential of the solvent is increased on transfer across the interface. Now, at some stage I showed you how to force elements into solution beyond a level where they have a certain solubility. Okay, so put more sugar into tea than its solubility limit by rapidly cooling molten metal containing solute. You force it to enter the solid, even though its solubility might be small. Do you remember the spinning wheel and molten metal pouring onto it so that the cooling rate is 10 to the 6 per second? Yeah? That's exactly this. The solute doesn't want to be in the solid, but it's forced into that solid by the very rapid solidification rate. So there are many technological examples of solute trapping. And it happens as follows. Okay, so let's imagine we are looking at solidification. So this is the liquid where the atoms are not arranged in a periodic array. Okay, you can see that this is a disordered array of atoms. And this is the crystalline material where we have long-range periodicity. We also have a solute atom here, which happens to be slightly smaller. And in order for these atoms to become a part of the crystal, they're going to have to do these motions to generate another layer of the crystalline material. And the distance between atoms is this delta here. So that is the smallest diffusion jump. Now, the diffusion velocity is the diffusion coefficient divided by the diffusion distance. Okay, so remember that the diffusion coefficient has units of meters squared per second. And if I write my diffusion distance, as lambda, and that is in meters, then the diffusion velocity is equal to b upon lambda. Okay. So what is the maximum possible velocity with which a solute can diffuse? So looking at this equation, what is the maximum velocity with which a solute can diffuse? solute can possibly diffuse in this structure. Say it louder.
D.
D. No, D is not a velocity.
As a lambda is minimum, then the diffusion will also be
minimum. Right, right. And what is the minimum value of lambda?
Distance between two solids.
Yeah. This is the smallest diffusion jump. So the maximum velocity will be given by D divided by delta. So we know that solute will be trapped when the velocity of the interface is greater than D over delta. If that means that the solute will not be able to move away in time before it's incorporated into the product phase. And that's exactly what I've written down here. Okay, you can clearly see that the velocity, the diffusion velocity, is diffusion coefficient divided by the diffusion distance. And the minimum value of that diffusion distance is delta S. Therefore, that is the maximum diffusion velocity. And trapping will happen when the interface velocity is greater than D over delta S. Now, we're going to derive a very simple equation. So notice this is another way of getting an interface response function, because we've got the velocity of the interface here. So there's one approximation I'm going to make, and that is that even though we have solute diffusing ahead of the interface is moving at a constant rate. Now that is possible in practice. Yesterday we did a calculation where we looked at one-dimensional growth, and we found that the velocity is not constant because the size of the precipitate variable is square root of time. That means it's not the velocity, which is dx by dt, will be 1 over p to the half. The velocity will be proportional to that. Okay? So the velocity is not constant when you have this increasing size of diffusion distance ahead of the interface. But if I had a particle which was shaped like a needle, then it's actually partitioning solute in many directions. And this tip is advancing into fresh material all the time. Then it will grow at a steady rate, a constant rate, because it's moving into fresh material all the time. The solute is being left behind. Okay, so the diffusion distance isn't increasing. That's just by the way. So whatever, I'm going to make the approximation that we are dealing a steady state process. So, we've got this diffusion profile here. This is my precipitate here, and this is the matrix. And the precipitate has a lower solubility for solute than the parent. And its equilibrium solubility is C alpha gamma, as before. So it's the concentration in alpha, which is in equilibrium with gamma. This is the concentration in gamma, which is in equilibrium with alpha. This is the far field concentration. But because we are trapping solute, the interface is moving rapidly, the actual concentration inside the alpha is greater than the equilibrium concentration. So it's slightly different from what we did yesterday for diffusion control growth, where the precipitate has its equilibrium concentration. Here, the interface is moving so rapidly that solute doesn't have time to diffuse away, and some of it is being trapped. So the actual concentration C alpha is no longer the equilibrium concentration. C alpha is greater than C alpha gamma. Solute is being trapped. Everyone happy with that? Okay. Oh yes, I've written it down over here. Solute trapping when C alpha is greater than the equilibrium solubility. Okay. Now, this is what the interface looks like. This is the same diagram as we had earlier, where we have here the parent phase the product phase and the parent phase. And here we are plotting the chemical potential of the solute. And notice that when solute is transferred from the parent into the product, there's actually an increase in chemical potential. You happy with that? Because we are trapping the solute. It doesn't really want to be there. Therefore, its chemical potential must increase on transfer across the interface. So there will be a tendency for solute to go back into the gamma. So if we simply look at these two fluxes, we can work out the net transfer of solute across that barrier at the interface. Okay? So there's nothing complicated here. This time I'm not plotting the total free energy, simply the chemical potential of the solute. The total free energy must of course decrease when I form the precipitate, otherwise it wouldn't happen at all. Yeah, the solute is only one part of the system. The solvent is also moving. Okay. We are going to analyze this problem from the point of view of the interface. In other words, we are choosing a frame of reference which is at the interface so that it becomes a steady state process. You know, if I'm located at this position, then I don't see any change. I see the distribution of concentration there and the distribution of concentration here. But as this profile moves, I don't see any change in front or at the back. Okay. So we are analyzing this in the frame of reference of the interface. And the interface is moving with that velocity, and that much solute is being pushed ahead of the interface as the interface moves. C gamma alpha minus C alpha. Because this is a steady state process, all of these concentrations must remain fixed. Because if they change, then it's no longer a steady state process. And that means that this must equal those fluxes that we had in the previous diagram. The fluxes in that direction and that direction are simply given by the diffusion coefficient divided by the gradient of concentration across the interface. And to maintain steady state, this must equal the previous equation. That is, these two must be equal. And it becomes straightforward. We've got another interface response function. We've got velocity here. We've got concentration terms, diffusion coefficient, everything else is known. So this is a third interface response function. So as the boundary moves, you know, we've got solute diffusing ahead of it, we've got the transfer of atoms across the boundary, and possibly the trapping of solute atoms into the product phase. Now, just in case you decide to read up more about it, sometimes these equations are written in a different format, but it's exactly the same equation. So we take this equation here, we write K with a subscript E to mean the equilibrium partitioning coefficient. That means the ratio of the solid concentration in the alpha over the solid concentration in the gamma at equilibrium. So that's called the equilibrium partitioning coefficient. This is the actual partitioning coefficient, which is different because we don't have equilibrium. We are trapping solid. So it's C alpha over C gamma alpha. And it's written like this, where beta represents, in effect, a dimensionless velocity. Because velocity times the distance over diffusion coefficient is a dimensionless number. Okay? But this is not really relevant. We've got the equation here. We just need to rearrange it to get this. Okay? Now, I said to you at the beginning of the lecture that whatever equation I use to calculate the velocity, I must get the same velocity. So how do we cope with that? You know, we've only got one current going through all of the resistors. There's only a single interface moving. Yeah? So whatever equation you use, you must get the same answer for the growth rate. So we have let's assume we have two different velocity equations, and this is the driving force and this is the velocity. in our electrical analogy, it's the current and the voltage. And one of those resistors, where is the current varies linearly with voltage, as in Ohm's law. In another case, the current doesn't vary linearly with voltage. We can design a resistor so that it behaves differently. So these are two different interface response functions, and I put them in series. So what I do then is, first of all, I calculate the velocity for the first resistor as a function of driving force. I don't know which point represents the correct value of velocity, but I simply substitute in lots of driving forces and I get velocity as a function of driving force. So velocity as a function of driving force. Then I do the same calculation for the other resistor. So here is now the velocity varying as a function of driving force. Okay, I've simply plotted it in the other direction because I want a solution which will give me the same velocity for both equations. And that solution is over here. And that gives me how much driving force is dissipated in the first process and how much driving force is dissipated in the second process. So it's by finding this unique value of velocity that you know how much is being dissipated in each process. And then when you substitute the right values into the equations, you get exactly the same velocity for both functions. This is quite a lot to absorb, But you can see how the solution of two equations gives you the same velocity. Do you actually follow this graph? The only trick here is that I've reversed the scale for this one. Just to illustrate that they intersect, and that intersection point defines a unique velocity. Because there's no way of guessing how much will be dissipated in diffusion and how much will be dissipated in interface processes. We discover the proportions by doing this. If you have a third interface response function, it will also intersect at that point. So supposing I put on the solute trapping function, then I'd actually be able to discover the concentration of solute in the product phase, even when it's not equilibrium. So by solving these three equations simultaneously to get a unique velocity, I have the product phase composition, the parent phase composition, and the velocity of the interface. So I just want you to get the essence of interface response functions. Don't worry too much about them. I want you to understand how we get the dissipations in each of the processes. And just to show you some calculations here, this is just for illustration purposes. Here we are looking at the growth of a low temperature form of iron, which is called ferrite or alpha, in an iron carbon system. And it's growing from cubic F iron, which is called gamma. Now under equilibrium conditions, the solubility of carbon in alpha iron is almost zero. So it would be right over there. So at very high temperatures, where the driving force is very small, by solving all these equations simultaneously, you find that in fact there is no trapping of carbon. But as the free energy change becomes larger and larger, you make the transformation happen at lower temperatures, you're able to trap more and more until all of the solute gets trapped. And this is a very, very important phase called martensite in iron, which really strengthens the steel enormously. Okay, so a large amount of the steel that you see around you will contain this phase, which has trapped carbon inside its crystal structure. It's not the equilibrium concentration. It's thousands of times greater than the equilibrium concentration. And of course, once you have trapped all the solute, the velocity just shoots up enormously. It shoots up enormously because there's no need to diffuse anything in front of the interface. Have you got any questions? This takes time to absorb. okay, I emphasize. But I think you've got the essence of the problem, haven't you?
Okay.
Have a think about it and come back to me, okay, if you have any questions. Okay, see you tomorrow.